Now, let's turn to the legislature's vote today to overturn the veto of the congressional map that came out of the special session to redistrict. I will start by saying that I'm obviously disappointed. I am certainly not surprised. I knew when I vetoed the bill that was a possible, if not likely, outcome. And so while I'm disappointed, I can only tell you I would be very much more disappointed had I been complicit in having a map that I think is so unfair and unjust enacted into law. I am not. These people who are standing behind me are not. And I will remind you that over the past 10 years, the percentage of African Americans in our state has increased. The percentage of white citizens has decreased. And yet, notwithstanding that, and notwithstanding that in nobody in Louisiana, not the House, the Senate, Congress, not the PSC, not Bessie, nowhere do African Americans have districts where they have the opportunity to elect their members that are consistent with their percentage of the population. But as I've said before, the most egregious of these situations is in the United States Congress, where we have six congressional districts and exactly one a majority-minority district. When the population of our state is one-third African-American, and we know that it is, then simple math and simple fairness means that two of those districts need to be minority districts. That's pretty easy to understand. It's not easy to understand why the majority of the House and the Senate refused multiple times to do what is right and what is fair. And nobody should have to have a Voting Rights Act to tell them what is right and fair. Nobody should have to have a court interpret and apply the Voting Rights Act to tell us that what we did was unfair. And unfortunately, this demonstrates that the state of Louisiana, even in 2022, is not ready to come out of some form of supervision. And that is sad. It is tragic. Didn't have to be this way. I've said this before. I don't think there's another exercise of the legislature that involves more partisanship, more self-interest than in redistricting. And that played out, I think, to an unacceptable degree in the congressional map. I will tell you that it was a very easy decision for me to veto it. And I can stand on the other side of their vote today to override the veto to tell you that that hasn't changed a bit. I slept good last night. I'm going to sleep good tonight because I did the right thing. And I know that I and these people who are behind me are also on the right side of history on this one. With that, I'm going to pause and take a few questions, should you have them. Yes, ma'am.
They're saying that the state is not ready to be out of supervision. Yeah. So would you agree that Louisiana should still be under pre-clearance?
Well, isn't that obvious? That's pretty obvious. Now, I know that a few years ago, the Supreme Court largely gutted the pre-clearance section of the Voting Rights Act. But I think this absolutely demonstrates that. What is so hard about basic math, basic fairness? I don't get it. It's yes.
Yeah. Do you have enough independents from members in the House or the Senate where you thought you were going to block the veto override?
No, I knew it would be close, but I never counted to 36 in the House or to 14 in the Senate. I want to make sure that I don't know that in the House that anybody had the votes before today. Either side had the votes before today. Yes, sir.
Roy Darrell Adams, who voted with you in the last veto override attempt but voted against you in this one, said that one of the reasons he voted against you was that you made promises last time that you didn't keep. I'm wondering if you could respond to that.
Well, I would tell you that's completely wrong. And I've had conversations with Roy Darrell last night and then earlier this morning. He certainly never mentioned that to me. But I would just absolutely say that is 100% false. Yes?
Governor, how do you see this playing out in court?
Well, look, I wish I had that crystal ball. And I haven't done an exhaustive comparative analysis of all the cases that are moving through courts because obviously the entire country redistricted this year. I cannot imagine there is a more compelling case for the courts to take a look at and to overturn than the congressional map here in Louisiana. It's not even close. It's not like you have 30 districts and minorities, majority districts, and the question is whether you have one or two more. There are exactly half as many as there should be in Louisiana. And so we're supposed to give, in this case, the African-American citizens of Louisiana enough opportunity districts, meaning districts with majority, minority populations so that they have the opportunity to elect the congressman of their choice as their population is to the state as a whole, which is a third. Having one instead of two, you're 100% off. You are 100% off. I mean, that's just not even close. And so I would think this is the most compelling case in the country. I would hope, and I'm familiar with the Voting Rights Act, although nobody should have to know what it says in order to do the right thing here. I happen to believe that it's a very clear case that it violates the Voting Rights Act. And if you persist in always defining your communities of interest as they've always been defined, and to prioritize the least amount of changes to existing districts, no matter how the demographics change, and that's what you heard over and over and over again during the redistricting session. These are the communities of interest that we're going to preserve. These are the existing districts, and we're not wanting to change them any more than is absolutely necessary. If that is your priority, you will disregard any demographic change that is reflected by the census. And in fact, that is what happened here. And it is wrong with a capital W. I want no part of it. I had no part of it. I am not complicit in it. Go ahead.
Last year, you were successful in blocking a veto override of the bill that had to do with transgender people in sports. That bill's been filed again, or a very similar version. I was wondering if you plan to veto the bill again or not.
Well, I would hope it doesn't reach my desk. And if it does, I'll see what it says, and you'll hear from me later on that one. I can tell you that in the year since last session, there hasn't been a single incidence of an issue arising anywhere related to the subject matter of that bill, as there has not been at any point previous to last year either. But we'll take a look at it if and when it comes up here. But you all know my views on it. It's pretty sad, because it's theoretically a bill about unfairness, but as you've defined the bill in the bill, that unfairness, it isn't happening in Louisiana. But what is happening is we have some young people who have pretty severe mental illness in some cases, or I should say emotional issues. And it just seems like this is piling on to me. But we'll work on it. And, you know, I never discount the possibility that there can be some sort of a compromise or something like that. But we'll see. Yes.
Governor, as mentioned last year, you were successful in blocking veto override of the transgender sports bill. One working theory that you were not successful this time is that you spent too much political capital last year. If that's correct, and if not, what's the explanation for why you were successful in blocking it then?
No. Well, first of all, they're different bills, and the explanation is something I've already said. The single most partisan thing that happens is redistricting. The bill that has the most self-interest at stake is redistricting. And so that's what it is in this case. And I think it's unfortunate. As I said before, I'm disappointed, but I am extremely optimistic about our state and the opportunities we have in the session, which I think will resume on Monday, in order to make sure that we're making the investments that we need to make in our critical priorities. And we've talked about this, whether they're education, healthcare, and by the way, education at all levels, and healthcare, but also infrastructure, including water and sewer and broadband, in addition to roads and bridges and so forth. We have more opportunities ahead of us right now than we've ever had. And so I remain very excited about those things, even as I am disappointed about the outcome for today. And I just think it speaks so poorly of us collectively, what transpired today. And I think we should all aspire to do better, to be better. This was not our finest day. But I want to thank you all for coming out for the press conference. I do encourage all of you to check the weather, be weather aware, especially before you get on the road. And I'm not just talking to the people in the room here, obviously. I'm talking to all the people at home, wherever you might be as you watch this. This